Hey everyone, welcome back to another exciting episode of Breaking the Ceiling. All of us have one morning habit that we just can't seem to get out of, and many of us can't start our day without it. I'm talking about none other than coffee. I don't know about you guys, but without a good hot cup of delicious coffee, I can't get my day started, right? And today I want to talk to somebody who's created a new niche in India, who's growing that niche. And when you earlier wanted a delicious cup of, you know, hot coffee, you had to go to a Starbucks, a barista, or any of the other places. But he is giving you that same experience at home, at the luxury of just 3 feet away, press a button, and you get amazing coffee. I'm talking about none other than Rahul Aggarwal from Coffeeza. Hey Rahul, welcome to Breaking the Ceiling.
Thanks Ashwin, happy to be here. Thank you so much.
So Rahul, before we jump into Coffeeza, I want to know a little bit about your life till Coffeeza, and then we will jump into coffee.
So I'll start from my education. I grew up in Delhi, did my schooling in Delhi, after which I went to the US to Purdue University for my undergrad, and eventually again to Babson College for my MBA. Babson College is up in Boston. It's known for entrepreneurship. So I've always had this kira in me that someday I'll start my own venture. I come from a family business background, and my family is into the production of RFID tags, which are used in various identification solution projects. So I have been, you know, exposed to sort of the, you know, global coffee, you know, cultures for many years. And I spent 5 years in the US, and when I joined my family business, I was traveling around the world, spent a lot of time in the UK, in the Middle East, traveling around Europe, and everywhere I was really closely observing the coffee culture. And, you know, but I was still working in the family business. And I think it was around 2017, 2018 when I finally felt the, you know, the kind of strong desire to start my own venture. And I think the idea for Coffeeza came very naturally to me in that sense, because I saw this kind of gap in India in this home sort of coffee solution for, you know, personal home use, where there was a very big market internationally, and I knew that India would eventually catch up with the West. So that's when I started Coffeeza in 2018, and yeah, that's what brought me till here.
That is very interesting to see how you've left a very well established family business, right? I have a same background story. Tell me something, how was that experience? What was that last day like? What was that conversation like? Was it a long drawn saga of 2-3 months, or was it like a 30 second, hey, I'm getting out doing my own thing? How did it play out?
Well, it actually happened over a work-related argument, and I eventually, I think the idea for starting my own venture had been brewing in my mind for a very long time. And I think that was like one moment where I felt I didn't want to keep on doing this. I'd also turned 30 years old, and I had a 1-year-old daughter, and I felt I didn't want to, you know, I want to be a hero in my daughter's eyes, and I don't want my daughter to think that this guy squashed his dreams or wishes for, you know, just to live a stable, comfortable life. So I wanted to be a hero in my daughter's eyes, and I think it kind of all came together. And I said, okay, you know what, I think now is a good time. Either it's now or never. I mean, if I'm not going to quit now, I'm never going to go out there and start my own venture. And it didn't happen all at once, to be honest, because I mean, previously also I had, you know, expressed my desire to my father to, you know, to sort of step out from the family business. And I think at that time, him and a few other people also tried to, sort of convince me that it's a bad idea to leave a well-established business. Startup life is hard, and most startups fail. So, you know, everyone was throwing a whole lot of statistics at me. I think all of that kind of just failed when I think I saw the broader picture.
I think that one of the reasons that you mentioned that, say, it's because of your daughter, you know, that you did this. And that's one of the strongest possible reasons you can have it, because I remember about 13, 14 years ago, when we were just a small startup, I had hired a consultant to kind of help us with something. And he did an exercise with me and the team at that time saying, hey, what drives you? Right? What motivates you? And for me, many people said, oh, growth, money and careers and things that way. But for me, I said, yeah, I want to be a good, you know, role model for my kids when they grow up. And that time, the funny thing is, I didn't have kids. So people are like, what do you mean? Because one thing I knew, and that's something that my parents probably did, is that they were role models for me. Like, they both started out with nothing. They both, by the way, worked together. They built a fantastic... And I wanted to do the same. Right? I wanted to do something. And it was me and my wife that started Equinox together. Right? You know, we wanted to create something that we would be proud of. And I think something that our kids would be proud of, that we were able to achieve, you know, something good in the world. So I can completely resonate with you know, why you want to get there. So now tell me, when you were starting Coffeeza, how did you come up with the name? How did you kind of figure out that, hey, I just want to do normal coffee? I'm assuming you would have tried out, you know, a few ideas. So what were your ideas? And how did you zoom in on Coffeeza, and how did you come up with the name? So it's a three-part question.
So name was easy. I wanted a .com domain. I from day one I wanted to be I always had this desire that I want to do something globally, something internationally, and so I looked around for .com domains, and the Coffeeza.com domain was available. I had to purchase it though at a premium, and I contacted the owner, and there was a bit of negotiation, and then yeah, I bought the domain off of him. So I think that's how I got the, you know, .com. I think that was a very good investment I made early on. You know, I mean, for starters, starting out, it felt like a huge amount, but you know, it kind of made sense. Then I think how the idea, you know, I zoomed in on the idea. So I was, you know, when I said, so coffee has always been a passion, and I think I've looked at other ideas. I mean, I've looked at product, you know, of like products for infants, food products for infants and children. I've looked at probiotic beverages. So I was generally interested in the food, nutrition, beverage space. And I think it kind of dawned on me. I was traveling around the world. I was doing exhibitions. I was visiting food exhibitions in Europe and in the Gulf. And just to sort of understand what was happening in the industry, and it kind of just dawned on me that, hey, look, there's this innovative idea in coffee, and that's something I have like a very good sort of understanding of from, like, you know, all the past experience that I have. It's something I'm very passionate about. Why not give this a shot? I mean, later I did realize, I mean, it was not as easy as just launching a coffee brand. I mean, because we entered into appliances in the form of machines and coffee at the same time. So these are two different things, that they're different sets of compliances, they're different sets of challenges of selling the, you know, each of these. I think it, that's how, I mean, I think there has to be that bit of sort of being a bit you know, unprepared, naive, jump into it. I think that kind of, otherwise you would chicken out.
So most people who get into entrepreneurship actually don't understand what they're getting into, right? I mean, if you understood the full breadth and depth of it, then you'd be like, you would actually hesitate more. So sometimes, you know, not knowing some of the perils can go a long way to, you know, get that courage to take that first step, right? I'm a serial entrepreneur, owner of multiple businesses. For me now, it's easy to say I can start a new business. But back then, when I started the first one itself, was difficult. When I decided, hey, I want a second one, everyone was like, are you crazy? Like, isn't the first one bad enough? But I'm like, kids, the idea is there, and I know I can do something with it, right? I know I can do something big with it, right? So, but in the beginning, it was, you know, very, very scary. So tell me about some of the challenges that you faced, especially with, let's say, recruiting your first team. What did you face any challenges? Was it very easy? What, you know, what kind of tactics did you use? What kind of people
did you use? Start off, you know, we started off bootstrapped. In fact, even today we are bootstrapped. We have not taken any external funding till date. And I think my initial team was, I didn't have this whole, you know, how tech startups, VC funded tech startups have this mindset that from day one I need a chief growth officer and chief revenue officer and, you know, things like that. I just started with a very basic team of a couple of, kids out of college. And basically we kind of learned and, you know, hired on a need basis. And I think it's now that I'm, I feel that there should be a certain structure and, you know, there should be certain people responsible for certain functions. And, but yeah, when we started out, I didn't have that kind of a mindset, sort of thing.
And what kind of people do you look for? What kind of traits do you look for in people when you onboard?
I think, like I said, I'm not looking for very expensive talent. To, you know, there's always a mindset that, you know, you're bootstrapped, so you have to be a little, considerate about costs. But I look for good talent. I mean, most important is the attitude. I look for someone who's stable in his career, not had too many job changes. And even if there are job changes, the person should be able to very, clearly explain the reason for those changes and saying that, oh yeah, because this company was giving me so-and-so growth, that's why I moved away. Because that would be a red flag for me that he could tomorrow leave me, you know, say if he gets a better offer from somewhere. But yeah, I think most importantly is the quality of, you know, the attitude, the personality, and obviously he needs to have the subject knowledge as well.
So at Equinox, over time, we've kind of, you know, narrowed down that craft of choosing the right people. And there is this whole concept of technical know-how, which is there. So there are teams who do that. But then another set of team comes in to look for what we refer to as a cultural fit. Right, so they need to resonate with our mission, right? So we want to make food, water, air in India safer, right? So if they understand that, they resonate with it, that's fantastic, right? Do we look at, like, do they understand our core values? Do they, you know, do those core values resonate with them? Like, do these make sense to them? Do these core values excite them? Right, so one of our core values is we turn thoughts into things, right? That means, hey, the power of good thoughts, or, you know, the actions you put behind those thoughts, you can actually make them into things. So that was a quote that's still in my office, like big, or like right behind the wall, it says thoughts become things, right? Because I believe that if you have good thoughts and you keep thinking about good things, and if you're able to action few of them as well, right, but do them well, you can actually create fantastic things. And those are the kind of people you want to onboard, people who can take action on their thoughts, right? Who can think independently, but also just not keep thinking, but actually do something about it. Right. So tell me about, do you have any mentors in your life today? Are you mentoring anyone? I would love to hear your thoughts on mentorship.
Well, I mean, I do speak to my, you know, family, dad, my brother, you know, for advice every now and then. First day, but, you know, I think I for the most part, I mean, I discuss a lot with my team, whatever ideas I have. I discuss a lot with my wife, who's also quite involved. You know, she handles the marketing side of the business. So, so yeah, similar to you and your wife, my wife has been a very strong aspect of Coffeeza from day one. And but per se, no, I don't have any specific mentors as such. You know, I rely a lot on journaling. I journal a lot. I write down, you know, ideas as they come to my head. And, you know, play my own devil's advocate. And, you know, I think that journaling brings out a lot of clarity to me.
Journaling, I find, is an extremely powerful mechanism, right? If you are able to practice it over time, it's able, you know, you're able to take a lot of your thoughts, and once you start putting them on paper, they actually start getting clearer, right? So I journal and I board like a beast, right? So my new office, literally every surface available is glass. In the wall, there's glass, and then, like, there are notes, there are thoughts. So when we have a meeting in office, I never sit, I'm always standing. Like, even at home, once we even I started the work from home piece, I have a standing desk, the best investment I made so far, right? Because I realize I think better when I stand. I think better when I, you know, write, right? So that's been, and I'm glad to see that journaling has helped you. Do you ever go back and, you know, revisit some of your thoughts from 6 months ago, 1 year ago? Do you ever do that?
So what I do is I use, for example, one of the note-taking apps. So I am using Microsoft's OneNote. Now what I do is, but I when I journal, I just scribble anywhere, whether it's my notepad or if it's my computer, wherever. But sometimes I feel the thoughts are actually something I do want to save for future. I would either, if it's a digital form, I'll just save it into OneNote itself, or I'll take a picture and then I'll give it a title, and yeah, I would then revisit it at a future date. I think that helps.
So there is an app that I've been using for the last 2 years. It's called Notion.
Okay.
Something worth doing. I think it starts off free and it's free for a few years or whatever it is. But today, our entire org is on Notion. Notion for each team. I have Notion for each of my teammates who I directly work with. We have a page for every project, what we call special projects, right? Which a lot of our innovations, we term them as special projects, and we do this cool thing where we give them names like Athena, Jupiter, and I don't know why most of our projects have Greek gods names and not Indian gods. I don't know why, but that's just been the thing, right? So, but that has actually helped us because it's one place where everyone's thoughts kind of go and we kind of revisit it. So every meeting, we have Notion open, right? So anything we discuss gets kind of put in, because one thing I learned, and I learned this about 6 months ago, once you have a meeting and if you come out of the meeting and if you don't have a learning or you don't have a to-do, what do you do in that meeting? Right? It's pointless. Like, you didn't take a decision, there was no learning for you to share. And if there is no to-do, you just basically had a chit-chat, right? And, which is okay. I mean, the meeting can be about a chit-chat, which is fine, but it wasn't a very productive, official, productive meeting, right? So that is something I learned, and I learned it from a CEO of a $100 million company, who, while he was about to go on stage, did this with me. Like, he's sitting with me, and I told him, hey, we'll chat once you're off stage. He's like, no, I want your thoughts on something. And he opened his phone and he started typing something. And I was like, then I paused thinking, hey, is he messaging? He's like, no, I'm taking notes. And then he had to-dos, he had learning, he instantly shared the learning with his entire executive team. He put his to-dos to his EA, who actually sent it out to me. Right? I was blown away. I was like, this is incredible. I've started doing that now, and it's absolutely life-changing. Right? So try Notion. I think it's going to be fantastic.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, we'll check it out.
So now I want to discuss a little bit about your business model. Is your business model purely online? Do people only buy from you online, or is that offline? Are you using Amazon? How are you kind of playing out?
So we are in typical sense a D2C brand, but D2C is a very confused term, and a lot of D2C experts tend to agree that it's a confused term. So D2C is direct to commerce, direct to consumer. Now, but people are agreeing that direct to consumer doesn't mean you have to sell only from your website. It's also through marketplaces like Amazon. So we sell through our website, coffeeza.com. We sell through Amazon. And then we do have a majority of our business does come from online marketplaces and through our website. And then we have an offline presence as well. So we are, Coffeeza products are available pan India across Food Hall, Nature's Basket, Chroma, and a lot of other gourmet stores, Limar, pan India. And we have not focused very extensively on the offline strategy, but I think this year we are starting to look at it more seriously, because we realize that for a brand, to build a brand in the long run, you have to be omnichannel. You cannot just be an online brand. Online is good to start off, to get your first kind of customers and your initial footing, but you need to quickly start expanding offline as well.
So today, out of your entire marketing mix, what percent would come from online, what percent would be offline?
I think about 70% of our top line comes from offline.
Online. That's pretty cool. But I think that the part that 30% is coming offline is fantastic, right? It's giving a good signal that, hey, that's also, you can't ignore the offline piece. Because I realized something the other day. I was in a store and I saw a new coffee. I was like, I took about 10 seconds to decide whether I should buy it or not, because very happy with what I had, right? Have you faced that as a challenge, that people will like look at a product and be like, should I take it or not? Like, I don't know if you've ever done this in-store observation. So I did that once we were at a expo, right? And we had this nice big stall, had about 20-30 people in Equinox t-shirts and all. But I kind of went about 30, 40 feet away and I was just for an hour standing and observing what's going on, right? So I see this young guy coming, you know, he's looking at all our panels. One person came, he said no to her. One more guy came to talk to him, he just, you know, they kind of pushed him away. Like four, five of my people approached him, but he just kind of, you know, shoot them away. And he's reading, but he's very curious about us, right? He's reading all our panels, like we have about eight panels. He read all of it for 5 minutes very intently. Nobody does that. And then he walked away. And then I went and I said, hey, I'm so sorry. I know I don't need to disturb you. Like, I'm the CEO of Equinox, right? And I'm very curious here. I mean, you saw all this. You read all this. I saw my team approaching you and you just kind of brushed them away. You know, what's up? Like, are you obviously interested in the topic, right? It's not, you're not just browsing. Like, you obviously, he's like, oh, I'm a food company, blah, blah. I said, then why don't we walk away? He's like, oh, your brand looks expensive.
Your brand?
Sorry? Your brand looks expensive. So I was like, we work with 3,500 startups. He's like, oh my God, you haven't put that on the board. Boom. Next day, 3,500 startups goes right up there. Right? So when I did that, it showed me, like, it gave me an insight which I didn't know otherwise. Because today, if you look at a website, like, if you look at your website, I saw your website, it's fantastic. It looks, you know, such a premium website. So do you ever get consumer feedback saying, I don't know how your coffee would taste, or do you guys look expensive without even knowing the price? Because I saw your pricing, it's so competitive, it's so, you know, you made gourmet coffee so affordable. I love that, right? But have you ever gotten any funny insight which was actually not the truth?
To be honest, we've not really, and this is something which we are currently working on, is that, you know, to create this mechanism to get, you know, insights offline. We have not started placing for, and the, you know, one of the easiest ways to do that is to start placing promoters in these offline stores. There's a cost involved of doing that as well. We have not gone down that route as yet. But we have, you know, we, our customer service team have this very strong, you know, as they talk to customers, they're getting feedback from them, asking them whether they like the product or not. If they stop buying, they would call them again and ask them, why did you stop buying? What went wrong? And from there, we, you know, we keep getting very interesting insights. And I think from that, there you kind of figure out the things you need to improve upon, like you rightly said.
So what do you do? What do you and your team do for innovation? Like, do you guys have meetings around it? Is it something constant? Is it something you do once in a year, once in 6 months? How do you handle innovation?
So I think innovation is something that has to be continuous. For our line of products, right? I mean, we started with, we primarily, one of our top selling products are the coffee capsules and the coffee machines. And I think for machines, we went through one or two newer versions, right? And this is again based on the customer feedback that we got. And for every new version, there was some improvement from the previous version. And also some new design changes and new functionality. For capsules, to give you an example, we started off with plastic capsules. And you know, now we have migrated to aluminium capsules. Which are fully manufactured in India, in our plant in Goa. So again, the whole idea was customers were telling us, move away from plastic, you know, and, you know, so as a brand, we started taking sustainability on a very different serious level. And, you know, with the new capsules, you know, we are definitely doing much better than the previous type of capsule, and this is innovation. I mean, we created a very state of the art facility here in Goa, and it's like a fully integrated factory, right? from crop to capsule.
Like the crop to capsule, that's pretty cool. So if I'm not mistaken, the aluminium capsule is like something that's happening right now. Like, you just launched it last week, or? You're launching it now, or?
Yeah, it's been launched. We are just now very excited for customer feedback.
That is fantastic. So there's so much joy when you create something new, and then, you know, the world actually enjoys it. I don't think anything beats that joy, at least for me. Like, when we created something new, so I'll tell you a story. About 2 years ago, just when the pandemic began, FSSAI had come up with a law saying that all restaurants need to have nutrition labels on their menus. Now, this is something which I know was in the works for last 4 years. But FSSAI started to work upon it again. what we did is we created a software from scratch, like board se chalu ke, like drawing lines ki this is how it should work. And within 2 weeks, my team was actually able to create a working prototype that we then did work with Swiggy, we did work with Zomato, and then many, thousands of other restaurants after that. Right? But it was so much fun to see the value that we were able to create, because if somebody went and actually did the testing, it would be 3,000-4,000 rupees for one recipe. We're able to do that at 1/10 the price and at 1/10 the speed. So if I say ever 100 times better, actually I'm bettering 100 by 100 times better, 1/10 the price, 1/10 the speed. We're able to do that at scale. But when people see and they're like, wow, I gave you 1,000 recipes and you gave it to me in 2 days. They're not able to fathom, and you saved me so much money. Like yesterday on a call with a client, he had 3,000 recipes. If he did testing with us, it would have been a 90 lakh rupee bill. We made it to less than 9 lakh rupees, right? And people were just, the customer was blown away. He's like, I mean, they were willing to spend testing. That's a big company, so they had the money. But when we actually told them, hey, we can actually do it at 1/10 the price, they were blown. And there was no negotiation. They were just like, here's the order, let's start, right? So there's so much joy in seeing your innovation work out. And I'm hoping that, and I know your aluminum capsules will get something very similar from your customers, because the next buzzword, by the way, is sustainability, right? Every meeting I've had with any, C-level person in the last 12 months, that word comes up every single time. So I think that what I heard from you is the first step towards, or maybe one of the step towards for you to take, go towards sustainability is aluminum. Is there anything else on your mind in terms of this? Are you thinking of anything else in terms of this?
We have been working on a lot of things right now. We are working on getting some environment certifications for our plant, and a lot of other, other things are in the works, in terms of having, it's still in the works, working on our, on the recycling programs and those kind of things. So, the whole idea is for the brand to be sustainable. We are here for the long run. And we have to be considerate about the environment as well.
Excellent. Have you explored the corporate market space? I know you're going direct to consumer, but have you done anything in the space of reaching out to corporates directly, saying, hey, you can keep our machines? Have you explored that space at all?
Yeah, we recently got a very very good gentleman who's a kind of a long timer in the coffee industry. He's ex Cafe Coffee Day group, and then he's also he spent over, I think, 18 years in the Coffee Day group. So he's pretty, I think now he is with his help, now we are reaching out to the corporates and other businesses for our offerings, right?
So, because I know that it's a very exciting space, right? And the multiples over there can be quite good, because even if you get one corporate, they would have 20 offices. So if they start at one place and they like it, the multiple is now straight away 20, and not just one machine, multiple machines would go obviously this thing. So how do you come up with new flavors? So I saw you have a bunch of flavors. So how does that play out?
I think this is also based on customer feedback. We asked our customers straight away what flavors they would like to see in Coffeeza's range. And customers came up with, some of the flavors, and then, that's the ones we are launching. So
that is brilliant.
Some of it is more of a hit and trial kind of a basis. You do launch flavors which you think will do well, and then you kind of launch it out in the market. And then if you have a big range of SKUs, some one or two might not do so well, and then that's kind of the nature of the game. So you realize that, and then you can slowly, in future, you can then accordingly adjust the inventory for that.
So when you come up with a new flavor, how do you have to produce it? Do you have to produce 1 lakh capsules, or can you do a run for 100 or 1,000, or how does that work? How does your R&D cycle work? Do you have to produce in large batches, or can you do small batches?
That's the beauty of having our own setup. We don't have to, we can play with small production runs and do a test run in the market and accordingly. So we don't have to invest a lot of money in the inventory and then later realize, hey, ye kaise beche? So I think that's definitely one advantage.
So I was giving it some thought, right? I knew I was going to talk to you today. After, I was like, what kind of flavors would be really cool to have? So something like a Nutella, something like maybe hazelnut, which is like Nutella, but much, much sweeter. Maybe during Christmas, have something minty. So I was thinking, like, have you ever thought of doing short run productions, just sending them to customers for trial, or, you know, and then seeing their feedback, or selling them as a Christmas special, Diwali special, or have you all ever done something that way or not?
I think it's now that we'll start doing that, because now that our production is all in setup and process. I think they're starting out with the standard flavors, your vanilla, caramel, hazelnut. And then, you know, in limited batches, we plan to do what I like to call ice cream flavors. So, you know, your quality of Nutella or your, you know, creme brulee and, you know, stuff like that. So, flavors which you can sort of launch in the market and see almond praline and, you know, things like that, which and see how the response is.
I love the ice cream flavors. Whenever you do launch them, let me know. I'll definitely be the first one to buy. And no, so I have this thing. I've switched to black coffee, like pure black coffee, about 2 years ago. And so I always look for some flavor in that, because just pure black coffee is a little intense, right? So right now I'm on the whole hazelnut phase. I think I'm ready to move to something different. So whenever you launch something else, definitely do let me know, right? So what does 5 years from now look like for Coffeeza? What's your 5-year vision for Coffeeza?
Good question. And that's something, you know, I'm asking myself every day. But the 5-year vision is, you know, we want to be a global brand. I think from day one, again, going back to the domain story of getting the .com domain, I think I've always wished to go global. And I think we want to be among the first Indian brands to sort of be known in the global space. We are now taking the brand to you know, markets like Singapore, USA, and I think from you know, like I said, we are the only, you know, company to have this kind of a manufacturing setup, at least in India, we have certain I think as a brand, we can, you know, really go there and make a dent with our, you know, unique blends, flavors, offerings, and while maintaining the same international standard of, you know, which like a bigger brand would kind of be only be able to offer till now.
That is brilliant. So one thing that I've seen, that will serve you well is your focus on quality and having a premium brand, because your product is a premium product. It is not designed to be in every single house. It is obviously a premium product, but it's also affordable, which I like the fact that it's, you know, premium but affordable. And you can always, once you create a bigger brand, you can always have something. I mean, your normal this thing, if it's X, you can have something that's 0.75X down the line. But it's difficult for a Maruti to make a Maserati, but it's very easy for a Mercedes to have, let's say, an A-class, right? So for a bigger brand to create a smaller thing is easier than a smaller brand creating a bigger thing, right? So last question for you would be, what would you advise somebody who is entering a food business or thinking of becoming an entrepreneur?
I think in the context of 2022 with the, you know, inflation and all that, I think the advice would be to tread a little carefully, given that, you know, all costs are rising, and you have to the rules don't change. You still have to have a differentiated product. You need to have a target market, target audience will buy a product. But I think you need to that mentality of, you know, burn cash, grow the business. I think that those rules are getting changed. And in fact, even a lot of VCs are advising their portfolio startups to sort of focus on profitability. So I think this is going to be tough year for startups in terms of those who are looking to raise seed funding and, you know, looking for growth capital. I think the advice would be try and stay as lean as you can. I think when there will be a better time. Maybe 6 months, 12 months down the line. And I think that's when you can start, you know, doing things more aggressive.
So I love the fact that, you know, you're bootstrapped and you've grown to the size you've grown to, at, you know, bootstrapped. Because today, when people look at the unicorns, the people, you know, people looked at the funded companies, there is a false sense in all the, you know, the younger generation that, oh, if I have a company, I have to raise money. Like, that's the only way, right? And I've seen so many companies shut down because they're not able to raise money. I'm like, did you try doing it bootstrap? No, we were planning to raise money. We didn't raise money, so we left the idea. I'm like, one in 100 will actually get funded, right? It's that other 99 who have the courage to, you know, grow, even maybe albeit smaller. I mean, you not grow 100x or 10x, you may grow 1.5x year on year. But even that kind of growth, but if it's sustainable over time, adds up to quite a bit, right? And people have this notion that, oh, we have to be funded. If you're a startup, you have to be funded. So I speak at a lot of colleges. So after one of the lectures, I was talking to somebody offline. And we're not discussing startups, and we're not asking the definition of a startup. So the guy said, the company that is funded is a startup. Like, that is not what a startup is, right? So for many of the young generation, that's their idea, that we have to raise money. Otherwise, you know, they don't even think of bootstrapping. So that is an advice I was actually giving to, I'm helping one particular B-school set up their ESET, right? So I was also looking at some of the curriculum. I was like, you need to teach students about how do you start companies. That has to be like a very, very defined structure that has to be taught, because it's not all about raising funds, right? Talking about staying lean, talking about what are the different kinds of costs, how do you control costs? I used to be an angel investor back in the day, right? Most of the time, I used to see companies fail because they focus so much on their product or service, they forgot to market. The marketing budget was 1% or 0.1%. And I'm like, what is that? They're like, no, we'll build a great product, people will come. They didn't come. Those companies today are shut. Right, so I love the fact that, you know, you have a brilliant website. I love the branding you've created, and I love the company you've created. Rahul, thank you for taking out time and, you know, giving so generously on Breaking the Ceiling. And I wish the very best for you. I will, you know, feel so proud when I see Coffeeza in Singapore, when I see it in Dubai, when I see it in London, when I see it in US, and I'm very, very sure it's within the next 5 years it will. And that time I will reflect back to this interview. And, you know, I will be like, hey, I spoke to him when he was only in India, but now look at the global success that he's become. Right. So thank you so much, Rahul, and hope to see you again on me.
Thank you so much, Ashwin. Pleasure talking to you, and a lot of fun talking to you and learning from you also.
Absolute pleasure. So guys, that was Rahul Aggarwal from Coffeeza. He has created, you know, a niche for himself. He is now a rising star. So do watch out for it. Do visit their website. Even if you're not a coffee lover, I think it's a fantastic made website. The link will be in the description below, and do learn something from his experience. Do learn something from what he shared today, and using that, I hope that you'll be breaking new ceilings very soon. Thanks a lot, and see you in the next one.